यदाहि धर्मस्य ग्लानिर्भवति भारत अभ्युत्थानम् अधर्मस्य तदात्मानम् श्रियजाम्यहम् प्रीत्राणाय साधूनां विनाशाय च दुष्कृतां धर्मसंस्थापनार्थाय संभवामि युगे युगे संभवामि युगे युगे In our last presentation, we started chapter 1 of Srimad Bhagavad Gita, and I brought to your attention that there are two concepts in chapter 1. One is dharma and one is karma. Dharma is the value system, and we discussed in detail what is dharma. And just to refresh it, I will touch it a little bit more, and then we'll go to the psychology and so on and so forth. All that total composite picture, there are rules. And those rules, we are subject to that. Whosoever at our own level will break those rules will have to pay the price. It is individual responsibility. It's a law of responsibility. You have to follow the rules. And there's no evident punishment. That is the beauty. So, if I'm talking to you and you are thinking bad about me, I don't know what you are thinking, but you are doing a bad thing. You are breaking the rule. Actually, you should not be thinking bad thing about me, you know, about anybody. So, the idea is there is no evident punishment. And so, since there is no punishment, people disobey the rules at their own level. So I am, just to reinforce it, I am giving the example that when there is no evident punishment, what happens? So if red light is not working and there is no policeman around, what we do? We break the rule. Either the policeman should be there to enforce it, or red light should be working. In the absence of all those two things, most of us will break the rule. And that is what we are doing. Because the enforcement is not evident and visible, and we think it's okay, but it is not okay. And it's a time-tested rule. Many, many centuries, thousand years have passed away, and these rules have not changed. We talk about technology and global and universal concepts in corporate world these days. The global thing is coming up. Until you are global, you cannot survive in the corporate world to do the business. But spirituality has been doing that many, many thousand years before. They said, Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinah. And it was the universal goodness for everybody. So, rules, which is the dharma, we have to obey it. We have to obey it. It's very simple. But I have to understand it, the seriousness. If I don't follow, life is not one-time experience. This is all chapter one. We will build on that. Life is not one-time experience. It's a cycle. Like everything around us, is recycled. Plants, trees, these, all creatures, they are all recycled. So we are subject to the same concept. We are made of five elements. Everything else is also made of five elements. When we leave the body, we leave these five elements. But something goes beyond that. That is what the beauty of human being. That is why they say that in Hindi, they say, ye manushya ka jo chola hai, बड़ा priceless है हजारों लाखों सालों के बाद evolution के बाद इस shape में आदमी आता है so Having said that, this is the ultimate apex point of evolution. Beyond that, we have still evolved. Everything is changing. So every day we are evolving for the betterment. So since the journey is a continuous, perpetual journey, but the rules are same. Whether I come on this planet one time or 10,000 times, the rules are same. So if I follow the rules when I am in a human form, this is a golden opportunity. We have five senses. All other creation on this planet, they have four senses, three senses, two senses, one sense. But this is the golden opportunity, and we have the ability, resources, and technical knowledge to develop the sixth sense, which is called the Jnana Chakshu, the eye of wisdom, which is here, through the technique of meditation and yoga. It is available. Whosoever want to advance in that knowledge, it is available. So, rules are same. Rules will never change, they are perpetual. It's a part of the creation. But why don't we follow? That is a human tragedy. Because there is no enforcement. Because there is no evident enforcement. So I think whatever I do, it's okay. But with this theory of dharma, it's intertwined the law of karma. They are all intertwined with each other. So if I follow dharma, I am building up a superior karma. Karma is a, the other day, I think last year I shared with you with utmost humility, that karma is a programming. We are all programmers. We write the program. The quality of the program depends upon the quality of my obedience and accepting the laws of dharma. If I am breaking dharma, I am writing a bad programming. So they are all intertwined. They are all building upon each other. So what, according to Bhagavad Gita, the wisdom of Bhagavad Gita, in chapter 1, what is dharma? Dharma, I said, it's a value system. So what is value system? The first thing is non-violence. Non-violence. It could be through speech, you may be hurting people. It could be a physical evidence, physically you are hurting people. Or it could be mental thing. You are sitting and thinking bad things. But choice is yours, choice is mine. Everybody is independent. We came alone on this planet. It's a solitary journey. And we will go alone. This programming on the chip, the subtle chip on which we are writing this program, being a programmer, that will go with us. And chapter 15, verse 15 of Srimad Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, I have seated in the heart of everybody. Sarvasya chaham haridisanya vishto matta samritir jnanam pohanam cha Vedaich sarvai rahmev vedyo vedant kridde avidhev chaham. I am seated in the heart of everybody. No human being is saying. It is the writer, it is the creator who created this whole celestial setup. He is saying that I am seated in the heart of everybody. Nobody should doubt it. I am the memory. I am the forgetfulness. And it goes like this, if somebody hold these three superior thoughts and practice it and make it perfect, then there is no need for that individual to read Vedas, Shastras, because this is the juice of all the wisdom. So let us built on this, that I am seated on, in the heart of everybody. So one program we are writing, as I explained to you, through the value system, obeying or disobeying, the quality depends on me. I am writing the program on a daily basis for the rest of my life. And one Lord Krishna is writing, because he is the evidence. We think Lord Krishna, Bhagavati, Hanumanji, all other deities, they are in the temples. We believe that. Sorry. We don't believe that he is here. And that is another tragedy. We don't have the conviction. We read it, we listen it, very many, many Mahatmas and lifted soul bring it to our attention that Lord Krishna, Lord Rama, Lord Hanumanji, he is here. But I don't believe. So that is why I think there is no enforcement. But it is the enforcement. Whatever I do bad, he is also writing. And when I leave this body at the final hour from this planet, the chip on which I wrote the program, it has to be certified by him. Because I am writing bad program. I may be selfish. I may not write bad things. I may write good things. So he certifies, and when he certifies, we get 10 out of 100. Because we never believe Lord Krishna is sitting here. We did many, many bad things, only not believing that he is there. And all our lives, we are trying to find Lord in the temples, gurdwaras, mosques, churches, synagogues, everywhere else, except here. Now, is it a technical knowledge? Is it some very hard thing to believe? No, it is not. But conviction, I have to bring the profound conviction that he is really here. And once I believe it, I am totally transformed. I am totally revolutionized from inside out. My intrapersonal relations, interpersonal relations, my conduct, my behavior, my speech, my thoughts, my eating habits, all will change if I believe that Lord Krishna is seated in my heart. In computer language we say garbage in, garbage out. So no garbage will go in because Lord Krishna is here. Our bodies are temple, moving temples. So that profound conviction, who has to bring? Individually we have to do it, whatever time we have. And we have to adjust the priorities of our life. This is the superior most thought, and I should put a lot of resources to practice this. Practice right now after this class, that Lord Krishna is seated in my heart. And then you walk and talk with that awareness. See the quality of your thinking, your action, your speech, your walk, your talk. You will change. You will change. Because you will have the awareness that you are being watched. You are being watched. And in real world, it is the mental game. You don't move things physically. What we think, we do. It's a very simple mathematical formula. Whatever we do, we think before, and then we do. People who don't do that, who do first and then think, they are in the jails. For them, there are a lot of facilities available who are antisocial. They become drug addicts, murderers, hurting the society, destroying now. In Paris it happened. This is what they are doing. They are doing something, but they are not thinking. And when they will think, since they are suicidal, they are already gone. They are destroying the creation. And that is not a universal value system. So, once I practice this awareness, then my whole body is a temple now. Whatever I don't do in the temple, don't do with your body. My eating habits will change. Now, whatever garbage is available, we eat, we all eat. But then with this awareness, you will be qualitative. That in Monday, I don't eat sandwiches of this type. Since this is the mandir, nothing should go inside. With our own hands, we open our mouth and put it there. Nobody forces. So this concept is such a big responsibility. You cannot blame anybody. Okay, he did, she did. There was a lot of food in the party, this and that. I was tempted. Whatever. You made the choice. So there is no blame, responsibility, work stays with you, with us. So once my eating habits are changed, what happens? If I eat the right food, what are the implications? Anybody? If I eat the right food, if you eat the right food, what are the implications? I will be healthy. I will be devoid of the diseases. I will stay from the doctors. Comparatively speaking, I will be healthier than the every person if I am eating right. And look at the quality of life these days. How much sickness is there? The other day I went to see some very close relative in the hospital. There used to be one hospital. Now for each little disease, 6-story buildings after building after building after building after building. Health industry has diversified so much. But human being the same. We have the same two legs, two hands, two eyes. Every organ is the same. Nothing has changed. It is because the eating habits are not disciplined, not controlled. Climatic effect comes. Your throat is bad, like my throat is bad today. But that has nothing to do with the eating habit. That's the climate also, where you don't have the control. I am talking about those things where you have the control, you have the choice. Better choice, worse choice. So, this wisdom of Srimad Bhagavad Gita, eat right, this is a rule of creation, this is dharma. So if you want to be dharmic, eat right. I am not saying vegetarian, non-vegetarian, intentionally and deliberately. It is your choice. I am just saying eat right. So then you will follow the rule, the value system. Second, I am just giving you little glimpses what the value system is. Second is don't gossip. Don't gossip. Because I brought it to your awareness many times. It is a cancer of mind. But we don't believe it. These days, the social setup, there are a lot of kitty parties, ladies, gents, and those are the 10 houses of gossip. What type of person we are? Do we have water somewhere? So, gossip is a mental sickness. It is breaking the rule of creation. You will pay the price. Don't do that. Don't do that. Hurting others. Don't do that. Selfishness. Don't do that. These are the rules. These are the rules. When you are doing something, think of others also. Think of others also. We come on this planet naked. We leave this planet naked. All this health, wealth, and fame and possessions, they belong to society. Because we are not allowed to take anything, and we don't bring anything. It is the society. So give back to the society. To give back to the society, there are ways. If you are rich, help the society through wealth. If you are intellectual, distribute your knowledge. Share your knowledge, your thoughts, and change people from inside out. That is a charity. If you are physically strong, teach people how you became strong. Don't hold it. The more you give, this is the law of creation, the more you give, it multiplies and comes back to you. So, through health, wealth, and other resources, help the society. This is the rule. Do not become selfish. If you want to advance in spiritual knowledge, always think globally for all. Help your family, but at the same time, help others also. And the other day I shared with you that the home in which we live, that is the smallest entity where you are the king. And they say that man is the king of his or her home. Right? So, if you are the king of your home, behave like a king. If you are the queen of your home, behave like a queen. Do we? No. There's a lot of misunderstanding between husband and wife. They're living together in the same place, they are eating together in the same kitchen, they are living, they have all the joint bank balances, all the properties, but they don't understand each other. So if you are restless at home, the moment you go out of home, you are making the society restless. When you are peaceful, the moment you come out, to whomsoever you are talking, walking, interacting, you are making them peaceful. But it is my choice. So under that guideline, to help the society, if you want to make society peaceful, become peaceful. Charity begins at home. And how to become peaceful? You have to practice that in your home. You are the king. Shakespeare said, but Bhagavad Gita said 1,000 years before what Shakespeare copied. When Shakespeare said, man is the king of the home, everybody was very happy because it is in English. But when Lord Krishna said many thousand years before, we think, it is okay. He said in Kurukshetra, who cares? No. Gyan is Gyan. So, the idea is, under the theory of dharma, it has to be practiced at home. If we are not doing that, we don't understand the operational part. We may have a concept theoretically, but that is the karam bhumi, jisko kehte hain. So, Mahabharata, they say the battle of Mahabharata was fought in Kurukshetra, right? With so many characters, humongous. But under this concept which I am sharing with you, your home and your body is a Kurukshetra. And you are fighting war every day. All those characters and villains, Bhishma Pitama, Duryodhan, the epitome of evil, it is here, inside. And when you are angry, when we are angry, whatever time, we are Duryodhan. When we are jealous with somebody, we are doing the same thing. Sometimes there is a beggar, you are going to office, there is a beggar on the way, he says, sir, give me 1 rupee or $1. You ignore him. But in the next block, another beggar is there and he is asking the same thing, sir, give me $1. And you gave it to him. The first beggar you didn't give. The second beggar, whatever your thoughts were, you gave him. This is what we are doing. This is exactly what we are doing. So, allegorically, historically, there was a battle between Kurukshetra, between Pandavas and Kauravas. All those heroes and villains, they were there in human form, and it's a history. But spiritually also, our body is a Kurukshetra, and there is a Dharmaraj also, Yudhishthira, who always followed Dharma. Whenever the word Dharma comes, the manifestation of Dharadrashtra, not Dharadrashtra, because he was the evil. He was the evil. Yudhishthira was the person who represents this quality of Dharma. We are also Yudhishthira. Sometime. But if you are aware that the battle is going on inside also exactly the same way, then I have to develop the qualities of the Pandavas. They are there inside. We have those resources, we don't tap it. We tap the other things, the evil habits. We are joining the forces of the Kauravas. But we are not putting our resources to be a part of Pandavas. So, spiritual battle in the human body, it is the concept of Mahabharata. Evil forces are inside and goodness is there. Judgment is yours. We are very independent. We are created in the image of God. We create people. God does not create people. Your children, you make the children. If you don't make the children, children will not come. So who makes the children? We make children. And that is the concept that God, everybody is created in the image of God because you have the power, creational power. You create people. But we blame God. If something goes wrong, God is there to accept it. No. I have to accept it. This awareness of responsibility will force me to follow the rules of the creation. And the rules of creation, I am saying again and again, is the dharma. Become dharmic. And the field where you are the king, that is your home. So follow dharma in your home. With your wife, with your husband, with your children. If your home is dharmic, you will make the society dharmic. It works that way. People are talking world peace. They go on the stage and give a lot of oratory of world peace. But the same person is so restless when he goes home, fights with his wife. You can say anything on the stage. It will not work. It will work only when it is applicable in your home. So if I want to be dharmic, we all must follow dharma, the value system, in our homes where we are the king and queens. We should behave like king and queen. That will enhance the inner beauty being a human being. So, I gave you a few examples what is dharma. One was, we started with non-violence. Then I said, don't gossip. Then I said, don't be selfish. Be selfless. And then there's another beauty. Cleanliness. Cleanliness. It is dharma. It is my duty to make the society clean outside. And it is my responsibility to make myself inside clean. Nowadays, the Prime Minister of India, he is enforcing, he is appealing to the masses, the crores and millions of people, he is asking, keep clean, clean the country, clean your neighborhood. It is a dharmic quality. It's not a political statement. It's a part of dharma. But we don't do that. We don't do that. So, one is outside cleaning, one is inside cleaning. Inside cleaning, we are all able to do that, but we don't do that. We don't do that. We have the awareness. So this concept demands that outside cleaning, make the country, the society, the village, the home clean. And make your body outside clean and inside clean. Outside clean. That we do. Because we interact with people, we take bath, we dress up, we make up. That we do. But inside we don't do. And the beauty of Bhagavad Gita is that we are not outside. Bhagavad Gita says in chapter 2, we are not the bodies, we are living in the bodies. It is just a vehicle. It is just a car. You are sitting inside. So even if my car is very good, let us say Lamborghini, whatever the product is, $250,000 car, right? And if I don't know how to drive, if something goes wrong and I am stuck in the highway and call the mechanic and it does little thing and the car starts, so you think, damn it, I didn't know that. That is what we are doing. This is very expensive vehicle, this body. But we don't know how to use it. Since we don't know how to use it, we misuse it and we abuse it. That is what we are doing. And dharma says, no, 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 don't do that. It is simple, it is doable. You have the capability, you have the ability, you have the capacity to do the right thing. So, cleanliness has to be inside the body and outside the body. Cleanliness has to be in the environment. That is say, don't pollute it. The concept of havan, yagna, Vedic thought, they have been practicing that. The concept of yagna in Vedic system It is to clean the environment. Don't pollute it. But now we are doing it. En masse, country after country, in the name of modernity, in the name of science, in the name of technology, in the name of resources, we are polluting the whole environment. This is adharmic. Somebody has to pay the price. And when the tsunami comes, then we say, wow, I don't know how it happened. Nature has to keep the balance. When the volcano will erupt with the ferocity and anger, millions will be killed. Because I didn't hear the dharma. I spoiled, as a society, as a country, the environment, and I paid the price. So, that is the bigger picture. But as a human being, this human body is so beautiful. It is so beautiful. Use it beautifully. Don't misuse it. Don't abuse it. Use it intelligently. Like anything else we do in life. So, this is what the dharma is. Take care of the environment. Now, do you have any more explanation you want to ask me about dharma before I go to the next concept of karma? Anything? Is it clear now to all of us that dharma is the foundation on which we are existing? This is an existential question. And once I understand that, the other concept of Srimad Bhagavad Gita will be in my lap. They say that it is your right pocket, you can use it. That will be like that. So this powerful and revolutionary idea and awareness of dharma will make us qualitative individuals. And it is our responsibility. Nobody can do anything on any behalf. We can help each other. But first of all, before we help others, help yourself first also. Then you have the resources to help others. Because we do give to the society what we have. What we don't have, we cannot give. So, with this thought, next presentation we'll do the karma, which is a beautiful, beautiful, you will love it.